You are about to receive messages that may be harmful to your mental state. Your sense of reality will be questioned. Your view on things will be altered. You are now part of the meta. The meta controls everything. The meta determines what will and will not happen. You are watching the Meta Show.
Hello! Welcome to the Meta Show. I keep forgetting I'm not on, like, Skype. So I have to actually key up to introduce everything, otherwise I'll get completely fucking lost. Hey, we're here! We're here! Jess Hubs!
And also, hello from me as well.
Yay, Mubin's here! Well, the Mutati! Sorry, I am sorry, Mubin. I introduced you.
That's right. I've decided, in the absence of Dear Leader, I've decided to give myself a promotion, and there we go. You'll also be pleased to know.
I like your name, though. The Mutani.
You'll also be pleased to know that I am wearing a red shirt. It is FanFest. I am slightly drunk, and I'm wearing a wizard's hat, so anything could happen.
You have a wizard's hat on! Hey, new subscriber! Woo! Okay, there we go. There's Uncle Pilot's thing. I was trying to get this all, like, lined up and proper. Sometimes it could be a pain here to, like, make everything perfectly like I want it. And now it doesn't look perfectly like I want it.
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah, it's sort of like a few interesting design choices there.
Yeah, but, so... You know,
it proves we're live, doesn't it?
I guess. I don't know. Are we live?
I hope so.
I don't know. Right, anyway, it depends if anyone's actually bothering to watch the show, you know?
Do you want me to go over roughly what we got as our top stories then?
We're going to go over. I can do it, but if that's okay.
You go for it.
Yeah, so, guys, welcome to the boat show. Fuck, this ain't the boat show. God, we're already fucking it up, Mubin. It's okay. We got this. We're at the Meta Show. Yeah, the Meta Show. That's it. That's where we're at. They're at the Meta Show. And in true fashion, the Meta Show, Mutati is not here. He's at FanFest. He is not around. So we're going to be having an interesting time. So today we're going to talk about CO2 and the failures of the war in Goons. During the Nullsec Power Hour, we're going to talk about the war in Syndicate, the war in the North, and we're going to talk a little bit about FanFest and some things that happened at FanFest. And then we're also going to talk about the T3 changes in the CCP Police segment, because holy fuck, they have just changed the shit out of those.
We also have a very special guest as well.
Yeah! We have a surprise guest. We also have our international segment, which we'll be talking with Uncle Pilot. So we have a surprise guest. I haven't revealed who the guest is going to be yet, because that's a secret. Because state secrets are best secrets.
I'm not sure it is that secret now, to be honest with you.
No one has any idea. Nope. Oh, wait, no, fuck! You're right! I was supposed to hide that! Shit! Well, Killer Bee's going to be here.
The surprise is over.
God damn it! That was supposed to be a surprise, but whatevs. It works. How you doing, Lumen?
I'm doing very well. Obviously, I've decided that I deserve a promotion, so I've, like, stepped up. It's been a very interesting week for me, because we've had some really quite good events that have happened in this past week. Not normally in the kind of conventional war sense, as it were, but, there has definitely been a couple of things worth talking about. And obviously, been keeping up with FanFest as well, and seeing what our future holds as well.
Yeah, I am excited. Today's show is going to be interesting because, again, with Mittens on here, usually he tends to, like, make sure I don't fuck up too bad. But with him not here, it's going to be a fucking train wreck. I ain't gonna lie.
Well, it's like,
Someone just asked, does the Mutati equal movement? Oh god, it does! Someone just realized the name, that's beautiful! Oh, movement, I love it. It's gonna be a great day. I'm so happy. After my work week, it's amazing. Oh god.
Right. Should we kick on with the show then?
Before we go to the top story here, let's go ahead and give some shout outs. Mad Viking, thank you for 7 months subscribing. Music Evil and Kane Felmont just hit the 2-year mark. Woo! 2 years. Yay. So I'm excited. So as we move on to our top story, One second. There we go. Now I can press the button correctly. Yeah, let's go to Top Story where we press this button. And, okay, so yeah, today's top story, we're going right into it, is, I titled this CO2 and the Failure of the War on Goons.
Yeah, it's, it hasn't been that impressive so far, really, has it?
Yeah, I don't know, impressive, well, you could say it's been very impressive for us.
Well, given the fact that CO2 were obviously the PvP backbone of any coalition that they're in, one would imagine that they would be making great strides with actually taking space and, you know, causing us great grief and strife throughout our membership. But so far, we actually seem to be holding up rather well under that particular strain.
Well, you see, the funny thing about that is, we'll go ahead and just jump into the gritty details here. The CO2 War on Goons has yielded no results. Their progress in Delve is none. There's no report this week. It hasn't changed from last week because there is literally nothing in the report. Like, it's that shit.
Well, to be fair to them, though, it's like, we did have a system that didn't have a TCU in it in Quirius because, you know, that's generally stuff that we don't care about. And I think that they managed to just sneak in a TCU and claim a bit of soft there for a few days. So, arguably, a little bit of progress. But meanwhile, over in Catch, I see that Space Violence still hold 36N, which is very nice to see. We've also,
Space Violence still holds Swiss, but, well, see, I didn't put this up here, maybe I did. Speaking of TCU, so we can go ahead and talk about a TCU that just happened recently, by clicking this link. I'd like to share that, a TCU belonging to CO2 has also went down this weekend. For those who don't know, FanFest is currently going on, and, Dear Leader, found a CO2 flag during the pub crawl and proceeded to be to steal the flag and take it with us. And then someone else then took tape and taped traitors across the flag.
And they draped it. Yeah. And I mean, obviously for the FanFest Capture the Flag event, we won that, yes. So that was obviously good news as well.
Yeah, so for those wondering, about the whole stealing of the flag, a lot of people go, oh my god, that's theft, what the fuck, why would you brag about that? CCP actually promotes taking flags at the pub crawl, everyone getting drunk and then proceeding to take the flag. That's a big deal for CCP, and they do it every year. The year I went on during FanFest, I made sure to keep the goon one. it's always hilarious to do that. So, getting into the degree of details, besides real life CO2 being bad, they're also bad in EVE. So this week they lost the Nightmare Fleet. I don't know if it was this week or last week, but
It was the 30th, they lost that. So it kind of doesn't count for this week, but they did make up for it this week with a somewhat impressive performance on their part, wouldn't you think?
Yeah, actually, they made it up with a very impressive performance, and our special guest, Killer B's here, somewhere. I don't know where he's at. Is he here? Someone find him.
Hey,
he's here! Yes! And he's going to tell us all about thing I just liked. Do you want to tell us what happened? What happened? What happened? What happened?
Yeah. Come on, story time. I demand story time.
So, basically, Kandar and his Space Violence squad, they've been roaming around, impasse in the CO2 space, and they noticed that, there's usually a bunch of supers and stuff that just drop on them. They seem to be very reckless with the supers and impasse. They feel really safe over there. Yeah. So that got to our attention, so we decided to set up for it. And Kandar did one of his usual romps again. He tackled a Rorqual in a belt, and, well, Rack jumped in, and they started trickling in some Apostles, some Faxes, and I think a Hello or a Vivern. So it was only one Titan and two Supers at that point, so we decided to jump in about eight or nine Dreads, just a few of them. And for some reason, because it was the goon gang that tackled the Rockwall, they associated those dreads with goons, and they reported them as goon dreads in their intel channel. And that made CO2 feel really comfortable to drop more Supers and Titans onto them, which they did. And once we had some serious tackle established on all of those, we dropped in the rest of our fleet, which was another 50 dreads, like 35 carriers and 10 faxes.
Oh, that's disgusting.
And then we just started killing Titans and Supers and dreads and everything until we got killed, obviously.
Yeah, I hear it's a good idea to drop a Leviathan at zero on a bunch of Nudian dreads. Can you confirm or deny this?
Oh, yeah, that was glorious. Basically, I think we killed like 4 Titans at that point, and we were like, okay, now we just got to clean up the grid. We didn't think we would kill another Super or anything. Just we were starting to kill carriers and dreads because we figured, okay, they have their full fleet here, so we're not going to be able to break anything. And then suddenly a Leviathan lands inside all of our dreads at zero with active tank. So, we just neutered him out and killed him within like 30 seconds or whatever. It was hilarious. He died so fast.
Oh,
so,
my God.
So how good did that actually feel then, Killer B, to be in on that particular operation?
I mean, yeah, it feels really good, but at the moment it's a pretty daily kind of thing. I mean, obviously that was bigger than a lot of things, but we are having a really, really good time at the moment with our curse deployment.
I've seen obviously that you've been very busy in this last week or so. Yeah. I noticed that the purple helmet people have also been kind of like active, which is Rocket X and that particular crew. You got an FCOM one, and obviously you managed to relieve us of one of our Shield Titans as well just the other day.
Yeah, so that FCOM Titan, he just jumped instead of bridged. It's the whole story about him. Actually, the kind of backstory, I don't know if you've read it, but the backstory about him is pretty hilarious because he jumped instead of bridging, and we didn't have any tackle ready on grit. We were scrambling to get tackle on that Titan, and he started lining out, and we were like, oh no, he's going to get away. And then as we jumped in a couple of our inties, I don't know why, but one of the Hictus decided it was a smart idea to put up a bubble, and he tackled that Titan. And then as we siloed him some initial caps, Addictory bubbled him as well, and then, well...
So I have a story about that. I have for those of you that want to see the link, I'll have it with you in a second. So apparently the FCON Hictor saw a bunch of your caps, but didn't realize it was a dread bomb. Just thought it was a couple of dumb caps. So he bubbled to catch those, and then he saw the dread bomb come in, so he was yelled at to take the bubble down. But then when the dread bomb came in, the Dictor thought that he was helping kill the dreads. So he bubbled and got the Titan too.
So, yeah, that sounds pretty accurate.
So they were both trying to, like, do the right thing, but at the wrong time.
Well, you have to bless them for trying. Obviously, things didn't pan out for them. Although it was nice to see that FCOM did actually have the forethought of shooting their own Titan, so it actually comes up as a kill on their kill board as well. So well done, whoever did that.
Also, I just want to point out, like, for those watching the background, these are the brand new sun effects that we talked about last week on the Meta Show. Coming at you live, there is currently a capital training op in progress on the test server. And you're getting to see the brand new sun and lighting effects. And that's why everything looks dark as fuck. Like, they're completely eclipsed by the sun's light. And all you see is silhouettes.
I want to kind of get back to a point then, Killer.
Yeah,
so actually the operation was actually something that you coordinated with Space Violent.
Oh my God.
And I take it that's the reason why there were actually 40 dicks that like Saber pilots that were actually showing up from the Imperium as being active in that particular engagement.
Yeah, they were they had some dictors and stuff prepared, obviously.
Okay, and I take it, you know, in that sort of stuff, then being able, if you hadn't had that tackle there, you know, what would have been your chances of being able to kill as much as you did?
I mean, we still would have killed it because we had our own tackle as well, but it was very necessary to have him around to A, be the bait, and B, to put the intentional tackle on it, so...
Okay, it's just that that was a bit lost on me when I was reading some other stuff about this kind of event. So, you know, I just wanted to make sure that our contribution to your efforts was actually worthwhile. And I noticed that there was in the region of about 900 billion lost in that particular event for CO2 and Friends. And you took a hit, you know, as well as other people for about 300 billion. So is that a good exchange for you? You're happy with that?
Yes. We obviously fully expected to lose all of those caps when we jumped them in, and they were all in short, so it's really not a big deal.
Yeah, you got to remember, Movement, that like the difference being they lost, you know, 800 billion of uninsurable assets compared to maybe that 300 billion is only going to cost 150, maybe even 125 billion at the end of the day.
Absolutely. So the question probably on everyone's lips then, Killer, is do you have another one set up already in that particular area of space?
We have dreads everywhere and all over the place, so you're safe no matter where you are. Yes. You're not safe no matter where you are.
No, you're definitely safe. Please go rat your
100% safe.
Now, I did see that the Goon Titan that you AWOX recently, someone told me that was a Peanut Smash himself in the AWOX character. Is that correct? Like, it was, everyone knew it was his AWOX character, and that corp just kind of fucked up.
That's Dumbleweed. I mean, I don't know if they knew it was him or not, but I if you have a look at the killbot of that character, accepting him into your corp is very special.
So there's definitely a lesson to be learned there when actually recruiting, to actually even do the most kind of cursory of checks to see whether or not you're potentially leaning in a known AWOXer.
I just want to point out that the bubble effects on the test server are so transparent that you can't, all you notice is like the outline with the sun, like a slight refraction. But oh my god, this is sex. I'm sorry. But getting back to the whole Dread Bomb thing, it's interesting because, I mean, like in my case, I do dumb shit with my Titan every day. You know, like earlier today I was doing something dumb. And it just feels like with the way the game's changing, if you have NPC 00 anywhere in range of you, or even, say, LoSec, you're fucked. But how would this work? Like, say you guys wanted to do this to the Drone Lands. Could you? Like, could you do a Dread Bomb in the Drone Lands? Like, would it be feasible?
I mean,
with
we
the
did
way...
it in Impasse.
Well, yeah, but Impasse was like, what, two mids and a couple of gates? I mean, but I'm talking like if you want to go to Osa or, you know, that area, like, can you actually get back up in there pretty easily?
I mean, HK is doing it pretty regularly as well, basically once a week at this point. It's not that hard to pull off if you want to.
Are you associated to Hard Knox at all then?
Yeah, Hard Knox is a PL old corp.
Yeah, you didn't hear that.
It's commonly known.
It's
been talked about for a while now.
I'd just like to make it clear.
Thanks. So yeah, the way it's looking, like CO2 is getting the short end of the stick on this deal. Now, for those that don't know, CO2 recently moved into Impasse. Or Impasse, however you want to refer to it, I don't know, to kind of hide from everyone else in EVE. You know, they figure, you know, it's not connected anywhere that's NPC. It takes a couple of midpoints. I mean, you see Gigax dropping his space turret on a gate at zero without giving any fucks to what comes through on the other side. So I'm just curious. I mean, does it lead to a new EVE? Is this a new era EVE where, you know, you're going to see goons with 100 dreads parked one jump from Tribute, and then you go to save a Radiant Titan with 10 Titans, and then they all die? I mean, is this a new kind of EVE?
Yeah, I think that we are making that transition, so... But please, Killer, you go for it.
I think
you
dreads,
have more experience.
I think dreads have always been relevant, but they've lost some... Like, people stopped caring about dreads around, like... Basically, like Black Legion was probably the last alliance that like used dreads really, really big in like on a regular basis. Obviously, there has been dread bombs in between, especially in low sec. You guys, when you dropped on tissue back then, and with snuff at the end of World War B, that was obviously a pretty big dread bomb. So dreads have always been around, but I think people are starting to realize right now that they're again, or that maybe they have always been, but they're coming back into like They're getting trendy again, to put it that way.
They're coming into fashion. Now,
yeah, into fashion.
One thing that's interesting about it, too, and one thing I've noticed with it, is that it leads to a scary time in EVE because, I mean, with skill injectors making AWOXing almost impossible to catch, especially if the guy does it within an hour of it happening, you have, you know, dread bombs that can literally appear out of nowhere because you could just build 100 dreads somewhere. Who cares? I mean, it leads to a new age of, like, watch yourself and be careful. Like, you're not safe in your own space. Like, with fatigue added to the game, it made it so at least you were a little safe. But all someone has to do is sneak 100 dreads around, and now you're not as safe as you thought you were. I'm curious to see how this will play out, especially with CO2 thinking they're nice and safe in Impus.
Yeah, more to come, for sure.
Yeah, so, yeah, that's our top story today, talking about, well, mocking CO2. We'll probably mock them some more in a little bit. We're getting more and more news as it comes in. Speaking of news, this just came to my hand that EVE Vegas was just announced a few moments ago. It is happening, I think, October 6th through 4th through the 6th. That is happening on soon, trademark. Yeah, so that's some good news. So, we're going to move on to the Imperium Brings You the World. Thanks, Killer B, for stopping by. If you don't want to stay the whole time, you don't have to. It's up to you. Unless you want to just talk about all the other stuff we're doing.
So, thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming. Appreciate it. So, Moomin, we move on. And before we move on, we, of course, got to have our shout-outs. So, Tuzzy, thank you for subscribing for 7 months. And Happy Little B has hit 20 months. Wow, 20 months is a long time. And Heraku, I don't know if I'm saying this correctly. I hope I am. Heraku44's $3 donation. Thank you, sir, very much for your $3 donation. And you said something really witty, but I missed it. All right, so we got to move on to this button. Where is it? Doop, doop, doop. So, around the world, and around the world today brings us to a very special place. For those that don't know, Uncle Pilot is a CEO in GSF. He's the CEO of Ascendancy. He's going to introduce himself fully in just a minute. Ascendancy, of course, is one of the better-known corps in Goons for being rather infamous. And then he's also our special guest coming out of the South African EVE community. And, of course, we're going to talk about that in detail in just a moment. So, Uncle Pilot, hi. Welcome.
Hey, thank you for having me.
So, one thing I always love is the South African accent because it's so much different than its British or counterpart because it's I just love it. It's so interesting to listen
to. I travel a lot, and I mean, our accent is so distinctive that I get recognized anywhere. America, Europe, wherever I go, people instantly know I'm from South Africa.
Yeah, so one of the things I want to know is who are you? Who are you? Because I hear Uncle Paul all the time when everyone says SNDC is bad, and we'll talk about why people are dumb and say that, but who are you?
So, yeah, my name's Uncle Pilot. The corp is actually called Descendants, but close enough. I have been in Goonswarm for probably about 5.5 years. I like space jobs a lot more than I like shooting spaceships in space, so I do diplomatic work for Goonswarm. I'm the CEO of Goonfleet. I was also the maker of Gooniversity back in the day. So that's pretty much my short CV.
Cool. Moomin, feel free to talk at any time.
Yeah, well, you know,
you can ask questions, you know.
Uncle Pilot. Yeah, no, I'm going to go for it. It's lined up. So, I mean, obviously, you were in Goons for quite some time. So, what was the driving force behind Ascendance then, Uncle Pilot? Is like, you know, how did that all come about?
Sure. So, we basically realized mainly via how many people we are able to recruit and scam. That not many people actually look at outside information in EVE Online. You know, in every game you get your more casual players. They don't really look at the meta game. These are the people that won't go look at their best build in World of Warcraft or any other game they play. And they basically log on to EVE. They look at the information they see inside EVE Online. And that's the exposure to the game. So what we then decided to do is to create a corp specifically targeting those people, the more casual players, I would say. And that was basically how Ascendant started. You know, during the initial few months, we were basically in all the systems in high sec and low sec, spamming our recruitment links, getting people into our recruitment channel. Since then, the corp has actually evolved a bit, and we became sort of a more mixed corporation. We still love those players that don't get the exposure to external media like Reddit and all those kinds of things, and we train them up on how to be useful in also.
So you would say,
so how was that? I want to get back to the organizational thing, because I mean, obviously with what you were trying to do there from an organizational point, now I seem to remember that you had quite a lot of success when you actually kicked off Ascendance. Would that be right in saying?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, basically, I was one of the first directors in Karma Fleet. So we learned a lot of lessons from Karma Fleet on how to recruit properly and how to background check people and all of those things. So I basically took all of the lessons learned from Karma Fleet as well as all the university stuff and applied it to Ascendance. And I think there's always a new time for corporations, or can't think of the right word now, but we basically went through the initial learning phases quite quickly, because we applied the learnings we've had from previous corporations.
And I reckon that it's probably quite a chore in its own right, given the demands that new players have, and anyone that's spent any time around new players, you know, there's normally a load of questions that they're asking you. And if you're not prepared for it organizationally wise, it can actually be quite a taxing thing. Would that be fair to say?
Absolutely. But and that is what makes Goonswarm unique for me. And I've said this to my directors many times, that if we tried to launch a corporation like Ascendance in any other alliance except for Goonswarm, almost guaranteed it would have failed. But because of how organized we are and the newbie-friendly institution that we've created, a lot of the information is already out there, and through our university squad and the SEC, you know, there's a lot of helpful players that already are set up to basically help new players come into the alliance. So if it wasn't for that, we would have absolutely failed.
One thing we tend to talk about with the international segment when we're getting into corporations is what it's like playing EVE Online from the perspective of your country. And so one of the things I'm curious about is that you live in South Africa, and with all the civil wars that go on in your country on a daily basis, you know, like sometimes it's one guy versus another. What's it like playing EVE in that environment?
That's actually a funny question. So the last war we had in South Africa was about 100 years ago. When we fought for independence from the British Empire. The main issues we have in South Africa are actually, like, we have a lot of political instability, underlying currents of racism, and then we also have massive crime problems, and that's mainly because of, you know, how poor people are.
I just love chat. Chat's like, wait, what the fuck? I'm sorry, I can't resist it.
I am, as a true Englishman, I'm just staying out of this one, to be honest.
Yeah, yeah. We've got many Brits when you guys, yeah. But yeah.
No, okay, but you know, seriously, like, what's it like playing EVE? I mean, I know, I think you're on the same relative time zone or close to, you know, GMT. But I mean, you're practically on the other side of the world when you think about it from EVE, you know?
Absolutely. So the main issues we have generally in gaming is if we play on European servers or specifically US servers, our pings are quite bad. Like on base broadband speed, we get like 200 millisecond pings, so that's quite irritating. But what makes EVE nice is that it doesn't require a really high ping. So, but from a competitive perspective, like Counter-Strike and all those other kinds of games, it's quite difficult. But except for that, I mean, it's very similar to playing games anywhere else. I don't sit underneath a tree with a laptop. I actually have a house.
I wish I could. Actually, I'll be honest with you. I wish I could go outside and do that. But that leads into the next question then, Doug. So, okay, what's unique about South Africa? You know, we have, like, you know, what's unique over about playing as a Chinese corp over, say, South Korean. So what's unique about playing from South Africa, say, over Somalia or Sudan and the corporations that come from those countries? What makes South Africa the say Ascendance, I should say, Ascendance, the unique place to go with it being from South Africa compared to those other countries?
Sure. So South African gamers, we have a community called My Broadband, which is similar to the Something Awful forum, but like specifically for South Africans. From the thread on there, you know, I guess we have about 1,000 people that play EVE Online in South Africa. It might be a bit more, a bit less. Of those 1,000 players, pretty much, I'd say 80% of them is split between two corporations, and both of those are within Goonswarm. So we
Wait,
have
really?
A corporation called Warp Course. Yeah, we have a corporation called Warp Course Stabilizers that joined us quite recently from an ally. And they are, I'd say, 90% South African. And then we have about maybe 50 to 100 South African dudes in Ascendance as well.
So I'm going to ask one more question before I let Moomin ask a bunch here. But well, why did you choose the name Ascendance rather than, say, Blood Diamond, as someone points out in chat? or Blood Diamond United.
It's actually quite ironic. So Ascendance, back when Goonswarm Federation had Section 10, which was sort of our rental empire, I created Ascendance as sort of a startup corporation for a rental corp. I sort of gave up on that idea and it never kicked off. When Mitani okayed the idea for the new corporation in Goonswarm, I pretty much just use the alt corporation I used.
Ah, okay, that makes sense then. Okay, go ahead, Moomin.
So, yeah, how do you feel about me becoming the new overlord of the Imperium? What are your thoughts about that?
I don't see your video on stream, and that's the problem. I have to see the quality
the red
of your
shirt.
Red shirt.
Yeah, we need a red
shirt.
That's
if
right.
You don't have a red shirt, then I cannot support you as well.
Do I assure you, red shirt is on, wizard hat firmly in place. I haven't threatened to kill anyone yet, but I might do as time goes on. We'll see whether or not we can actually Godwin anyone later on as well.
Yeah, oh, God! I did that last shirt. I got yelled at for it. It's okay. But okay, so
once I see evidence of the red shirt, then we can talk.
One thing we find really important here with our international guests is there's going to be a twofold question here. One, are you drinking? This is important.
Yes,
another international guest that's drinking. Perfect. And then
we invented drinking, I would say. As South Africans, we drink a lot. The Brits think they can drink, but they don't.
And then I want to know, do you know Afrikaans, I guess is the way to say it.
Yeah, I was going to say, you mean Afrikaans.
Yeah, sorry.
I do know Afrikaans. It's my home language.
So we need a recruitment speech to join Ascendance in Afrikaans.
Okay, I'll go for it.
Yes!
So, Goonswarm Federation is the best alliance in the game, and you're with Amal join. And
come on, you must have more than that.
Come on, we need a full recruitment speech here. Come on now.
Even I understood at least 50% of that.
That's the thing about Afrikaans. So, if you understand a little bit of German and a little bit of English, you can pretty much figure it out.
Okay, so you gotta give us more.
Yeah. I'm not gonna give you more, man. Oh. I hate speaking Afrikaans.
So, alright, so, yeah, that's awesome. The fact that we have a South African corp, when I heard that from Twizzle C, I always thought, like, I've never heard you speak, but I've seen you type, and I always figured, okay, maybe Europeans, you know, but when he said South Africa, I was like, oh, man! So, we have a couple of questions. One popped into my head earlier is, what do you think of the movie Invictus? Have you seen that movie?
I have not. I'm not a fan. I know. Yeah. I'm not a massively into South African culture. But yeah.
The reason I ask is like one of my favorite movies, and it's just it's so good.
So you probably like the Alien Neil Blomkamp.
Well, no, I just love. I mean, I'm not a big fan of rugby, but I love the dynamic between the rugby captain and Nelson Mandela in the way it's portrayed in the movie is so, so good. But anyway, so moving on.
I guess I was there, so you know, I lived through the 95 World Cup and all the
What was it like?
Hype around it. So, it was amazing, man. And it was shortly after South Africa became a democratic country, and it was quite amazing to see Black South Africans and White South Africans and Indian South Africans sort of stand together for the first time in our history. So. Yeah, it was quite a moment, and then the country together in a big way.
That is so cool. Oh, man, I'm actually really excited about that. So, yeah, dude, thanks. So that is our international guest. Seriously, thanks, Uncle Pilot, for coming by and talking with us. So good. So we're going to be moving on now. Oh, but real quick, I forgot this. You are the 10th largest Corp in Eve, the only other ones I can think of that are bigger, really, even though it says 10th largest, is Goonfleet, Pandemic Horde, and Karma Fleet. I mean, what's that like? I mean, do you guys... I've heard a rumor, and I don't know if this is true or not. Do you literally recruit at Ajita? Is that how you keep your numbers up?
So, no. So, I mean, as I said, so our corporation actually aims to recruit people that don't go to Reddit and all these other kinds of... I don't want to say bullshit places.
No, please go ahead. On this show, we rate the news and we say it how we want it to say it. So it is bullshit. Reddit is a bullshit place. You're more than happy to say that on this show. Yes.
Okay, great. So yeah, we don't recruit from Reddit. So literally the first 200 people that we recruited into Ascendance was us spamming our recruitment link. After that, there's still a whole process for people to get through. So that was basically to get people into our recruitment channel. After that, we interview them. They have to fill in some questions on our recruitment website, and then we go through the whole process. But since then, quite amazingly, it's been sort of word of mouth. And we were quite surprised, how quickly we've grown. We've been going now for 7.5 months, and we're at 1,400 odd players. So, yeah, the Corp is just doing incredibly well and better than all expectations.
Awesome. Well, thank you.
Well, I must say that, before you go, I must say it's like, thank you. It's always a pleasure, and it's always very nice to see your efforts as well in Little Bees, which is our help channel. And obviously, I'll see you in there again soon.
Yep, thank you, Kapala.
You'll always see me around newbie things.
Yay! Lord Axeman, thank you for subscribing for 4 months, by the way. As we get ready to move on here, and we are moving on into the NullSec Power Hour. We got about 20 minutes to go left in the show today. Lots of things still to talk about. We're actually going to try and get a whole show in today. Bits and pieces. Well, and usually it's Mittens talking all the time. That's the thing. So, yeah.
Well, I tend to be more reserved in my opinions.
yeah, my opinions are out there. All right, let's put it that way. So, as we move on, someone asked this in Theta earlier, should Care for Kids, since they have now retired, Moomin, become Care for Darfur? as a joke related to our previous guest.
Yeah, it's like, Care for Kids. Don't start me on that one again, really.
So it's you ready to mock Sword Dragon? Are you ready?
Sword Dragon, that's going to be an easy one, though. It's like, surely. It's sort of like, I think he was a little bit disappointed at the results of the CSM.
Just a little bit. As we move on to our next story here at NullSec Power Hour, Guardians of the Galaxy, or DOTG, failed to get their member elected to the CSM. Sword Dragon was the number one choice. And he was none the happy about this. CSM 12 was officially announced yesterday, I believe, last night, whatever. It was announced at FanFest. FanFest is going on this weekend. It was announced. And they announced the candidates that made the trek, of course, Steve Renukin, Rylod. For those that don't know who Rylod is, he's the guy that does Z-Kill's Guide to the Ships. The Judge, of course, making it again. He was on our ballot. He's a CO2 guy. Newman from Hard Knocks made it.
He's one of our proxies, isn't he?
No, yeah, he's an awesome dude. Judge is a chill dude. I hung out with him in Vegas. Got Jintan again, of course, the very quiet Jintan. A nominate, and Aerith from the Goons. Setonia from Karma Fleet, which of course he's more of like a solo PvP type, so not really the same. Brave Newbies, and then Vince Draken. Now, the interesting thing about the Brave Newbies candidate is that he got on, but the Pandemic Horde and Guardian of the Galaxy candidate did not get on.
Now, is that surprising to you, given the actual numbers that were involved there? Because when you actually look at the GOTG coalition as a whole, there's a lot of numbers there. Pandemic Horde, there's a lot of numbers there.
Dude, yeah, 15,000. GOTG combines for about 18,000 between all of the different parts of that. So you're looking at 30,000 votes that did not matter at the end of the day. Just didn't matter. I mean, Vate Striking got on, and I'm pretty sure he, you know, cracked the whip on Pandemic Horde a bit, but Pandemic Horde had its own person running.
So, you know, with that, because, I mean, given the fact that it would have been block voting, people would have obviously put forward their candidates and who they wanted to represent their alliance. What went wrong, do you think, Bo? Because
I don't know yet.
I haven't heard. Yeah, because
block voting has it goes been... wrong. Let me explain how it works. Yeah, so it's individuals in there thinking for themselves. So here's what happens. With our voting system, and the same with places like CO2 and in places that got their candidates on, they do what's called block voting, where they literally like have their website dedicated to this is how you vote, this is the buttons you click, don't do any thinking for yourself, you don't have to go through and find candidates. Because what people tend to do is when they have to go through and find candidates, they're just going to pick who the fuck they wish, or they pick the first six or seven, right?
I think that I want to kind of like stress on this as well. I'm not actually a big fan of free thinking individuals.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So you end up in a situation where they free think, right? Well, in our case, you just have to click the button twice. You click the button to open the page, you sign in, you click the button to submit. Done. You don't have to think. And so you happen like a case like, I think, Test CEO. That dumbass was literally going, well, I'm not going to force you to vote for a candidate. You pick who you want. FCON CEO, I'd like you to vote for our two candidates, but I'm not even going to put their names down in the fucking broadcast. I'm just going to say, you know, vote for R2, and that's a good idea, but you can vote for whoever you want. Fuck that shit. Autocracy, the motherfucker. CO2 did it right. CO2 followed our example. Give them a voting list. Judge gets in. They vote. See, like, I don't know if you know this or not, but it's called being a diplomat, right? Our diplomat team is the best in the world, right? And they get in there and they...
Well, do you think that the CO2 approach has anything to do with the many years that they actually spent within the Imperium as a whole?
Well, I don't know if it's that more as... Would you rather have your candidate, i.e. the judge, on the CSM or have no candidate at all? Because CO2 is so small, even if they gamed the system with Test and Brave, they weren't getting the judge back on there. But by reaching out, like the judge himself, reaching out to our diplos and going, you know, hey, fellas, look, we'll vote your dudes. You vote judge in. Help us out. We'll help you. Done. And I think judge was like fifth or sixth or maybe third or fourth on the ballot because he's a cool dude, right? So it ended up working out for them very well. Whereas in the case of Sword Dragon, well, fuck Sword Dragon. Goodbye.
Yeah, and I think that the GOTG also went expletive towards Sword Dragon.
I think it's hilarious because if you look at the Reddit thread I linked in the chat here, you literally have a situation where he says, oh my god, I can't believe you shitbags voted for that guy. And that guy was number 10 on Sword Dragon's broadcast for who to vote for.
We just had a question line pop up. Sword Dragon is the coalition leader of Guardians of the Galaxy, and he is well known for not necessarily being the most trustworthy individual in EVE, shall we say.
Yeah, he tends to do GoFundMes for his personal benefit rather than personal, like... Look, don't get me wrong. A GoFundMe for a family emergency where your family's in the hospital is a big fucking thing, right? That's a good deal. That's a very good help. But for... What the fuck? What the fuck? I just got like this. This is not work safe. But it's on Reddit, so you can actually click it.
Right, okay.
Click at your own risk. Apparently someone stuck a sticker of the CO2 symbol in the urinal at FanFest so people could piss on it.
I can't quite see it. What's that down in the bottom left there?
What the fuck? Oh, the CO2 shitter. You know, it's getting even better. It would have been better if it was in the shitter. But
anyway, yeah, if you're easily offended, please don't click that link. But,
fuck.
Okay. It's nice to know that some people are having fun over in FanFest.
Or someone's really drunk. Either way. Man's gonna love this. We're linking dicks on the mouse show. Speaking of the FanFest event, Zenuria got arrested.
Personally, I think I wish you'd go back to just making references to Hitler and World War II. But
Nope, not allowed. Nope.
Yeah, sorry, you were saying. Zenuria obviously had a bit of attention.
I don't know if he truly got arrested or not. Reports are vague.
I don't think it was.
Some are saying he was arrested, some say it was role play. But he did try to steal a bunch of chips off a table and tripped and fell. And apparently the picture shows him, looks like, quote-unquote, getting arrested. Someone said, the guy that picked him up said he was arresting him for trying to steal something. But from what other people are now saying is that he was just being helped up. So, but the picture just looks
okay,
so perfect.
Okay, so, yeah, but yeah, I knew it was like, you know, a photo opportunity that can be missed. But, I mean, equally, they were handing out the tokens, I take it, then, at some point?
Yeah, so the tokens are
part
of the RP event.
So how can you steal something that is being handed out?
So each person would get one token, and then that token was used to vote a certain way, right? Like, vote for this, vote for that. And then, in the case of Zenuria, he came up to the table and just tried to grab an entire bag of them, but the bag was torn, so they scattered everywhere.
Worst theft ever.
Yeah, so he made it like 2 feet with the entire bag. Because his plan apparently was to like game the system by handing out multiples so people could like vote 10 times instead of one to try to get it to go his way. Because, well, it's an area. What do you expect?
Yeah, I have seen him pop up on the stream at least on one occasion. So, yeah. So what else have we got happening in Power Hour?
In the war of the shit-flinging, that's Tri versus the entire North, nothing happened this week at all. They must be on vacation or something because there's nothing. Not a single fucking battle report. I mean, maybe there was a kill here where like they farmed up 1,000 dudes on the one side, but Tri seems to be kind of dead at the moment, not doing anything. So there's not much talk about there, but we will move on to the war in Syndicate. I was not there for this, I don't know if you were, but Goons dropped 200 carriers to help Initiative along with some low-sec dudes. And NCDOT was forced to pull a CO2 and self-destructed an entire Macario fleet rather than try to run home. They either self-destructed it or died.
It was something that I did actually happen to be about for that one. And, you know, it was a really interesting and good fight. Although I hate using that particular phrase.
Right.
And the boosh that was done by the T3 destroyers from Initiative at the start of the combat was probably one of the most beautiful things that I've seen, definitely in quite some time. So it was like kudos to Init for actually starting our particular piece of combat with that particular maneuver. It was truly a joy to behold.
That's just fucking amazing. So I did hear that Papusa was running the subcav fleet, which for those that don't know, Papusa is known as Pipe Bomb Papusa. He tends to get blown up by battleships, smart bombing out of gate. He's notoriously alone, I would say close to 100 fleets this way. It's disgusting. And as far as I'm aware, you know, he actually chased NCDOT all the way home and then made his fleet home safely, so I thought that was kind of hilarious that NCDOT lost to Papusa, of all people.
Well, it was really kind of good day, and funnily enough, there's this relatively mediocre writer for INN who actually did a battle report for that particular fight as well. So if you want details there, pop over to Imperium News Network, and you'll be able to read about the whole thing there.
Yeah, so... also, NCDOT is continuing to call on Guardians of the Galaxy and Pandemic Horde, their pets, to come help them. So, but that's basically what went on. Syndicate, the timer got saved, and it was in a final timer, so that's really cool. And then, of course, we move on to the war of GSF versus CO2, of course.
I just want to go back, though, to the X-TAC M2 fight. 2,400 people were in system, so it was, you know, by EVE standards, it was a pretty significant event. There were lots of people that turned up to this one. And the other interesting bit about this is most of these people are lined up against the Initiative, who are up there on their own most of the time, which means it's in the region of 3,000 Initiative versus about 30,000 others. So at the moment, they're fighting the good fight up there with odds of about 10 to 1.
Yeah, I don't understand how they pull it off, but, you know, it's Initiative being Initiative. They're nomadic. So the thing is, they could probably just leave Syndicate and not even give a fuck. And the way that they are,
yeah, and to be honest with you, it's like I'd be more than happy for them to like pop down our way, like, you know, come set up home for a bit and just kind of like chill, make some money, and get ready to go off and on their next crazy adventure, to be honest with you. But we'll have to see what White Init do in the future.
Yeah, so the funny thing is too, of course, we talked about this with Killaby here. Actually, we can skip that. And yeah, so that's it for the NullSec Power Hour. And we got about 8 minutes left. Or actually, less than that. We got 4 minutes left. Holy shit, we are running out of time here. So I do want to quickly move on to another story that has arose pretty much today. And I haven't had much time to look into it myself. But it is absolutely fascinating. And so it needs to be shared here. So we move into CCP, please.
Please, sir. I want some more.
Okay, and of course, with CCP, please, I'm going to bring you an image that is pretty amazing. The, I guess, nerfing or changing of T3 cruisers is coming, and it is coming big. And if you haven't seen yet, I'm going to show the picture live on stream here in a few seconds so we can talk about this. But it's a huge deal right there. Bam. For those that don't know, the defensive core, offensive, and propulsion systems are now going from 25 subsystems to 12. So again, a huge deal there. They're primarily moving the cloak module to a defensive mod rather than its offensive mod, which meant that you could like fit a cloak and a pretty big tank. Now you have to pick. And they're also adjusting a whole lot of other shit. And according to people on the ground, the entirety of the PL delegation at FanFest was in groaning. They were really upset about this. They're blooming the SIG of T3 cruisers. The SIGs are going up by a crazy amount, apparently, enough to make it so that those things will be pretty bombable. And then they're also adjusting like some of this other stuff. So what do you think, Moomin? Is this good or bad for the game?
I always look at it is you can't have progress without change. So you need to kind of like change stuff and mix it up. And, you know, to be honest, generally I trust CCP to actually make the long kind of term corrections to where they kind of drop the ball. I mean, EVE's a very complex game. There's lots of different facets to it. How stuff will pan out, you know, you can never like tell for sure.
Right.
But I do trust CCP and our CSM to actually look at these things and to get them changed where appropriate. Now, as far as I'm concerned, the T3 cruisers, they've been like, you know, the top of the food chain on sub caps for just so long that it's ridiculous realistically. So I'm looking at this as a very interesting change that is potentially really going to mix stuff up. Not only have effects on how PvP like happens, it can have effects on PvE and also the marketplace as well. So you know, and it's a bit simpler as well, which is always a good thing for an old person like myself.
Yeah, this is going to be absolutely insane, because you're looking at right here where it says offensive, remote reps, and bursts. So I don't know if that means like you can now have to pick between having your remote reps or your bursting on the same module and offensive. That's going to be interesting. They're also you know, combining things that make things like slippery peats are getting a big nerf here, according to reports from people that are at FanFest. So this is going to be huge. Like, I don't know if
With the SIG increase, obviously, slippery peats, like, you know, they no longer are a thing, because they were literally right on that cusp of being, like, probable, unprobable. You know, if you increase that signature, then basically slippery peats, that should no longer be a thing.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm interested. CCP has been needing to hit these with a stick for a long time, and they're going to finally do it, I think. And also, another big stick that's coming, and I don't know if you've heard the news about this, but the ability to bomb capitals.
No, I hadn't heard about that, but I must confess, it's a little bit with these particular types of announcements and what will happen in the future. I at least like to wait until they're actually happening on Sissy before starting to think about it, because it can change so much between now and when they actually push it out to Sissy, and then equally from Sissy out onto TQ itself.
Where it's interesting is, so the bomb change, that for those who don't know, they're releasing a new bomb type that will go along with the Capital Void Bomb. I don't know if you've ever seen that one. It's a Capital Void Bomb. Where it has like a 0 meter radius, like you have to hit it right on the motherfucking chip. But things like Titans have such huge SIG radius, or like size, that hitting a Titan with that bomb is no big deal. And it zaps a ton of cap, and it's designed purely for capitals. It doesn't work well against any subcast whatsoever. But when it comes to an actual damage equivalent bomb, that is going to be absolutely disgusting, because if you look at motherships do not fit smart bombs anymore like they used to. They fit those fighter damage mods that take up your high slots. So if you don't have smart bombs, you can't blow these bombs up. And that could be game-changing, especially when CCP has said that they're looking at having 100 of these be able to be detonated together. Normally, bombs can only be detonated in groups of 7 before you blow up all the other bombs and make it pointless to go over 7. And
yeah, that would, I mean, that was always a real annoyance, especially for Bomberwaffe. I know that much is like that. You had to plan all of your bombing runs to actually take into account for that mechanic.
Yeah, it's going to be huge. For me personally, it's exciting, because now you're going to look at a situation where a bombing fleet, if done right, against purely capitals, has the opportunity to kill capitals. You throw a couple of these void bombs, the capital void bombs on a Titan, now it's out of cap, now you're hitting them with those damage bombs, they've got no hardeners, and then you start torpedoing them. It's, oh, so good.
So you're excited about that one. So
oh, I'm very
when
excited.
Is that, when were they kind of planning on that one?
Looks like summer. That's going to be, like, usually when they talk FanFest stuff, it tends to be summer to December. But we'll see. I don't know. This FanFest doesn't seem very exciting to me in terms of, like, everything they're releasing. Because if you're looking at, like, a lot of the stuff they're saying, it's not what you would expect. Now, of course, they showed that they're changing the modules for T3s, and we knew the T3 balance changes were coming, but there's no official numbers yet. And for something that's expected in the summer release, based on the leaks that happened about a month back, you'd think it'd have numbers by April, especially when the summer release is usually in June. Having those numbers not in our hands yet is kind of an interesting thing. So I'm really excited to see what it goes with that. So I'm very excited.
Yeah, I could imagine it's like I am as well, because as I mentioned already, you can't have progress without change. So you know, we're definitely looking for interesting times. I just hope that the changes are considered and rolled out in a way that is measured to allow us as a community to actually adapt to those changes, and that there is some overarching plan as well. But from what I've seen with, like, Citadels, we've got the Conquerable Station stuff, which was announced as well, and I think that's going to be interesting. I think that, there's plenty of stuff to be looking forward to this year.
Yeah, I'm excited. And with that, we are out of time. We're going to move on to the boat show here in just a moment. We're going to play some EVE Online today. I'm going to go harass some people in EVE. If you'd like to come with us moving, of course, you're always welcome on boat ops.
Oh, I think I'm actually going to be busy in real life, because I'm just about to go and I'm just about to go and kill a pizza.
Ooh, I actually, I'll be honest, don't laugh too hard. I'm trying to lose weight, but have you ever heard of something called Oreo lasagna?
No, can't say I have.
You know what an Oreo cookie is, right?
Oh, right, yeah.
So take Oreo cookies, mash them up into like almost like a powderish, like a lower, like imagine like a cake, like consistency of like a crusted cake. Put that on the bottom layer. Then whipped cream frozen on the next layer. Then chocolate pudding frozen on the next layer. And then another layer of whipped cream. And then chocolate, what do they call it? The little chocolate chip morsel things on top.
And this helps you lose weight, yeah?
No, I made it for all the teachers at my job, and they loved it, and I have a lot left. And it's not going well. But I did want to say, though, real quick, before we go here, MetaShow people, I hit my one-year mark. Today is the one-year anniversary of when I started losing weight. Or not losing weight, like working out. So I've been working out officially for a year, so... Oh, so good.
And it's all going good for you, yeah?
Oh, yeah, I'm down 50 pounds exactly in a year, and as far as weightlifting goes, I have almost doubled everything I started with, so...
Yeah, well, as you can tell by my picture, I'm quite a big chap, but...
You're very hairy, that's for sure. That's... Well, Mutani...
I still oil up nicely.
Mutani,
but anyway,
you.
It's like, thank you very much for having me on the show. Yeah. And obviously, yes, I am now the new overlord, at least until I get told that I'm not a gay.
Yeah, so. Okay, well, thanks, guys. We'll be back in a few moments with the Mocho. Bye.
You are about to receive messages that may be harmful to your mental state. Your sense of reality will be questioned. Your view on things will be altered. You are now part of the Meta. The Meta controls everything. The Meta determines what will and will not happen. You are watching the Meta Show.